Hello, everyone. My name is Hannah Clark, and I am one of the co-VPs of communications, along with Kiana Dittmar McCollum, for the Anthropology Society here at UW. I am so excited to introduce to you today's guest for our Live Life Story series, Associate Professor Dr. Maria Liston. Dr. Liston specializes in Greek and Roman bioarchaeology, with most of her prominent research being on infant and fetal well disposals in the Agora of Athens. The wonderful creator of this event series, Camila from Pescod, has prepared a wonderful discussion of Dr. Liston's journey into academia, all about her research and her life as a bioarchaeologist. I'll never forget Dr. Liston's guest lecture in my Anth 100 class. I had Dr. Hayes, and she came to do a guest lecture for us, and it was just such a beautiful lecture, so interesting, and she was very excited. So I'm really excited to hear about what she has for us today. Enjoy. Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Hannah Clark, and I...
There we go. Thank you so much, Hannah, for that introduction. And thank you so much, Dr. Liston, for joining us today. We ran into some tech troubles earlier, but nothing that we couldn't solve. We're here. You're here. We're happy.
Yes.
Yeah. So, just getting started, you had a really eventful summer. When we were talking a couple months ago, when you first told me that you would be willing to do this interview, you told me that you might be able to fly to Greece or you might not be able. And then a couple of weeks ago, news were that you wouldn't be able to be there. But now you're here. So it's been an entire trip there in Greece, not here with me. It's been an entire travesty. So can you tell me more of how that came to be? Like, how have your plans for the summer changed? Had to be rearranged? Tell me about that.
As you know, the world changed on a moment-to-moment basis all summer long. But eventually, the EU was allowing even American citizens into the EU as long as we had a residence permit. And I have a Greek residence permit because I was here on a sabbatical. So when I checked in at the airport, I wasn't sure they were going to let me on the plane. Mm-hmm. And at every stage, I wasn't sure they'd let me on the next plane. But they finally, I got to Greece. So here I am.
And now you're there. Where were you before? Were you in Waterloo?
Yes, for the most part. I was at my home in Elmira, just outside of Waterloo. I spent the first couple of weeks after I came home from Greece with my sister's family. And then before I flew out, I went back to see them and my father and dump my cats on my sister's family so I could leave. So a little bit of both in the US and Canada.
Of course. Well, I mean, it's wonderful that you did manage to get to Greece. I know that your research is so important. How long are you planning on staying there for this time?
I'm leaving August 26th, so staying as late as I can and still come back in time for classes to start and make sure some of the technology is working better than it did this evening.
Of course. It's quite a learning curve to learn how to work with all these new techs. I've been learning every week. But if you are in your lab in Greece and people that have had the honor to take courses with you, we know that you talk about your lab in Greece all the time. Do you think you could do the honor of giving us a little tour around the lab, showing us your favorite things?
Yes, I will do that. Now, this would have been easier with my phone, but I'm going to just turn the tablet around. It's the back camera has not been very reliable, so we're going to stick with this one. So, let's see. So, this is the bone strewing room in the laboratory. It's formerly the Malcolm H. Wiener Laboratory of Archaeological Sciences at the American School of Classical Studies in Athens. So that's its full name. And it's a big three-story building that we've been in for about 4 years. Initially, we were in what was the garage of the American School for about 15 years. And then we got this nice new enormous building built. Yeah. Flint Dipple, who is the other person working here, just fled, so he's gone away, but he's always working on the other side of the room from me. He's a zooarchaeologist. I think you can see some of the bones here. He's working on animal bones from a big site called Phaleron and another one called Azoria in Crete. And here in the middle, there's another biological anthropologist that works, but she's gone for the evening since it's after 7. And then my work table is over here. And let's see, sorry, there. And I'm working on an early Christian and Byzantine site that has a bunch of people who had leprosy. Sorry, it's so hard to aim this from behind, but so I've got foot bones here of individuals who had leprosy. And if I can find my own hand, this is, and there's a bad lag.
But I can see you well.
Well, yes, it's very difficult, but anyhow, this is why I wanted to do this on the phone, but we'll go with the technology that works. Yeah. So I think now I will go upstairs, so I won't disturb Flint, who's trying to get some work done. He's leaving to go in the field tomorrow. So I'm going to grab my power cord, because of course my phone power cord's upstairs, but I didn't think I was using the computer.
Do you have it already?
Yes, I've got the cord. So I will head for the elevator. If it works like the tech did, you'll lose me for a minute, but then we'll be back.
Perfect. We'll be able to tour the rest of the lab. The very interesting elevator.
Yes. Looks like an elevator pretty much everywhere.
How many people work at the lab on a regular basis?
This summer, of course, is really light because we have to restrict the number of people. There are 3 staff who work here, and then today there may have been as many as 7 or 8 researchers.
Wow, that's... And then... We're back.
We're back, yes. So I said today there may have been 6 or 8 people here working besides the staff. In a regular summer, they're often 20 or 30.
Wow. And that number.
Yes. And now we're up in the library where I have a desk. And I just, because the way this is going, the power no doubt would run out on us. So I think it's important to plug it in. All right. We're settled.
There we go. Beautiful. And yeah, I can imagine that if the same number of people were working at the lab before you upgraded to this beautiful new facility, it might have gotten crowded with living people.
We couldn't. If there were 4 people working in the old facility, it was, we were running into each other all the time. So we love our new building.
I can't imagine. But you said that you were returning to Canada late August to make it in time for classes. And I was wondering, I know that you will be teaching human osteology, which is a fabulous course. It's been one of my favorite courses that I've ever taken, ever.
Thank you.
But you're going to be teaching it this fall term online. So how is that going to work out? Like, I feel like I'm speaking on behalf of many concerned students.
Yes.
Want to know how that's going to work out. How will technology come into play for this?
Well, it's challenging, but one of the probably the most important thing we're adding to it, and I have to give Alexis Dolphin credit for suggesting this. It was a brilliant suggestion. She found an inexpensive but very detailed plastic skeleton that we can order from a Canadian company. Every student in the class, instead of buying a textbook, is buying a complete plastic skeleton.
Wow.
So people will have the bones. I mean, this isn't a $1,000 or $5,000 one. It's not super high quality, but it's got all the little details we need. I was really impressed with what a good skeleton it is. And then I found some free resources that we can use as textbooks. So the textbook I would have ordered was $140 and the skeleton is $129. So people will be able to then compare photographs and videos and things to the skeleton they have at home. And for part of the quizzes, I'm going to have, you know, some questions you identify the photograph, but then others, you have to send me a photograph of yourself pointing on the skeleton or on the bone where that fragment comes from. And I'm thinking about having, instead of written exams, doing short, you know, because the osteology class usually has weekly quizzes and a big final. We're not doing a giant final, but doing live things where we Skype or Microsoft Team or whatever, and I have a series of questions that I ask people and they pick up the correct bone and show me what I'm talking about. So that's how we're going to do it. I mean, you know, I'm making lectures and narrated PowerPoints for the basic material, but we're going to use those plastic skeletons that everybody will have.
Yeah, I'm sure. I know, because my little anthropology chat is going crazy over here. They're like, oh, that sounds awesome, and it sounds so relieving because we were worried. But I know that, I mean, you're an amazing professor, so I know that this path you're taking is going to be very successful, and it's very innovative. Is that how you pronounce it? Yes. And it's very innovative, so... it's really, all in all, it's really cool to see like the boundaries we can push past. But talking about your human osteology course. So one of the highlights for this course for me was that in the first week of classes, you told us that the person that got the highest grade for each of the mini quizzes would get a bone pin. So here I have my prized possessions. So I value these as my most important material possessions ever. So I wanted to know, is there anything similar that's going to be going on this term on one side? And on another side, I want to know, what was your motivation behind starting giving out these like little prizes as incentives?
My brother-in-law is the director of a state historic museum in North Carolina. And years ago, they did a big exhibit on piracy in North Carolina. And of course, in the museum shop, they had little things to, you know, sell to children, as well as books and stuff on piracy because of this exhibit. And when it ended, they had a whole box of glass rings, you know, those sort of, you know, just big fat glass rings that had skulls and crossbones on them. And they weren't selling. Once piracy exhibit was over, nobody was buying them. So I made them an offer for the whole box and gave them out in osteology that year as prizes. And, you know, people seemed to like it, but I wasn't sure whether you might think this was a little juvenile or silly. And so when they were gone, I didn't think about doing it again until, I think it was even before class started, someone said, well, what are the prizes this year for the quizzes? It's like, oh, okay, I guess I better find something. So the bone pins were great. I've never found those again, but I often have pencils with skulls and crossbones on them and skull-shaped erasers that go on the end and that kind of thing. So, but it's a challenge every year. But perhaps I need to come up with something and mail them out to people because it seems to have become an important part of osteology.
I feel like it's also somewhat of a status symbol amongst like anthropology students when like you pull out like one of your prizes from Dr. Liston's course and everyone's like, ooh. So.
Well, I need to go on Amazon and eBay and see if I can find some more really good ones. That's where I end up getting them now.
Of course. So continuing talking about like things that I've learned in some of your courses and just across anthropology as a whole, we've learned as a discipline in anthropology that race really has no biological basis, right? And instead, we know that they're like social boxes that are interpreted differently by different cultures. But I wanted to know, why is it in the syllabus of, is it that in the syllabus of certain courses, particularly forensic anthropology, why is it that we still learn about race? Like, what's the reason for this?
Well, I mean, race doesn't exist biologically because people don't have discrete categories they fit in. But there are clusters of features that tend to be shared among people of different geographic ancestries. And those are very real. And of course, we see them. I mean, the whole Black Lives Matter movement is because people with a certain geographic ancestry can be identified and discriminated against. So while race, which, you know, technically means that, you know, these discrete boxes doesn't exist, ranges of variation do in skin color and face shape and hair type. I mean, these things exist. And particularly within forensics, if the police need to identify someone, I mean, you've got unknown remains that have been in Northern Ontario for who knows how many decades, you've got to narrow down the population of potential missing people. And we do that with sex, and we do it with age, and we do it with this thing we call race, in part because that translates well to the police. But, you know, they know to go looking for someone whose family, you know, resembled this geographic group. We need to change the vocabulary, but there is variation in human beings, and we can see it in the skeleton, particularly the skull. And at times that's important. And even, you know, as an archaeologist, I'm in Greece. It's not that far from Africa. There certainly were people of African ancestry here. I mean, one time I was looking for a particular skeleton in the Agora, and I pulled out a drawer and picked up the skull and was rather startled when I realized I was looking at someone of African ancestry. So wasn't expecting that. Nobody had ever noted it before. So the variation exists. The problem is in the terminology we use to describe it, but it's real just as much, you know, as stature and age and sex, which isn't the same as gender, are different, you know, varies. So we have to deal with it.
Of course. And what you were saying about changing the terminology, I also feel like it's so important because words such as race that are so charged in like a cultural context, if people from the wrong groups, like from white supremacist groups or like eugenic groups, they see that in a scientific context, we are still continuing to use words such as race. And I feel like that gives like fuel to their arguments, and that shouldn't be the case. So you are very right in that sense.
I try to use ancestry is usually the term I use to substitute for it. And unfortunately, I was educated in a time period where race was the common term, and I will slip up and use it sometimes, but I try to be consistent in using ancestry. I mean, that it's not a good term either. You know, it really doesn't make a lot of sense because we're not talking about families or things like that. But at the moment, that seems to be the most neutral generic term we've got.
Yeah, well, it's going to be a process. But I know that as a, when I was talking to Dr. Park a couple of weeks ago, it's just like a plane flying overhead, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Is that we have to see like the pattern in anthropology that we've taken towards like just being pioneers and everything that is like social justice related and equity related. So like I'm confident that like as new generations of anthropologists emerge, we're gonna find the correct terminology and we're gonna be able to find the best use for our knowledge. And then again, talking about from a bioarchaeological perspective, okay, so we know that we can only really understand disease, illness, trauma, just general pathology as it is as it manifests on bone in an archaeological perspective, right? Mm-hmm. So I wanted to know, in your experience, what would you say is the most interesting pathology to study in an osteological context?
To some extent, it's the one I'm studying right now. it's whatever I'm focused on finding and such, but I am very interested in infectious disease and the work I'm doing with these people who have leprosy. I've learned a tremendous amount about it, and now, you know, leprosy once was an epidemic, certainly across all of Europe and the Mediterranean. And so the recent pandemic has made that more poignant in a way. So I'm interested in the effects of differing infectious diseases and trying to figure out what they are. I'm also very interested in trauma, even though the violence that usually goes along with physical trauma is difficult, but it's physical trauma as opposed to things like burns or frostbite or things like that, which are also trauma. But it's the place where we most closely can recognize an event from the past. You know, this happened at this moment. And sometimes it's accidental trauma. You know, often it is violence and warfare. But I do find that fascinating to be able to reconstruct an event that happened to an individual. So the moment those two.
Speaking of reconstructing events, a story that stuck with me from your paleopathology class that I think you would be surprised at how often I actually think about this story. About two Greek women whose bones were found intermingled in the same well that are thought to be victims of the Heruli warriors. I think they were labeled as AA13 and AA14. I checked my notes, but I couldn't really be sure. But do you think you could describe their various like injuries and pathologies they were found with and what their mode of death ended up being?
Ah, yes, they were very interesting. I mean, as you say, they were found together in a well. They were found sort of mixed in with debris from the cleanup after the Herulean sack. And so that's how we associate with this attack. It was one of the early Gothic tribes attacking the Roman Empire. And so it's moving into that period. Two women, they were about the same height. They were about the same age. So it took a while to reasonably confidently sort them out. But I, you know, things like fingers and toes, I there's just no way to do. But anyway, it was interesting. One of them had bone cancer. And it was a metastatic cancer. As a woman in her mid to late 30s, it could very well have been a breast cancer that was the primary tumor, but it could have been anything else too. I mean, metastatic cancer, you can't really distinguish what tissue it started at. You just know it's now metastasized to the bones. So she was in poor health and she had lesions on her skull, and of course, breast cancer does metastasize to the brain as well frequently. So she was in very poor health when she died. But both of these women died violently. That woman has a series of sort of chop marks on her head, where her head was hit with some sort of pretty heavy blade, but it was dull enough, it didn't really slice into the bone. It just kind of chipped away at it. I mean, they're kind of long cuts, but so multiple cuts that would have definitely knocked her out, and the resulting concussion, hematoma and such might have killed her. I don't know what her immediate cause of death is. The other woman had some broken facial bones, so she was hit in the face. But then she has a cut right on the corner of her mandible, right here. And that is fairly classic from someone who has had their throat slit. where if an assailant is standing behind you and cutting across, the blade tends to come up and will catch the mandible. And it's pretty classic in the forensic literature. So I'm pretty sure her throat was slit. I don't know precisely how the other woman died, but it was presumably from this trauma.
I think, as I was telling you, I think of this story so often and how it really just captures the importance in fire archaeology of understanding your context on one side, and then on just like revising your work and making sure that you're not missing anything, because you might have thought that she died from like the Lefort's fractures and injuries related to that, but when it was actually most likely this tiny little cut over here in the mandible. I think it's fascinating, really. Like, they died a really sad death, of course, but I feel like it teaches a very valuable story for our discipline. So talking about that, how do you think that this case informs us in a forensic context, that how jumping to like flashy conclusions can sometimes blindside our research?
Well, I mean, it's true, although in this case, these women, what I think is the right answer is the more flashy, or certainly the more violent one. But yes, it's always tempting to do the thing that is going to excite interest and make a good publication or get you on TV or whatever. And that's not always the most appropriate. And I think it's always important to back up and make sure that you're not jumping to that conclusion just because it's exciting. Because sometimes it is, but other times it is a more prosaic, ordinary explanation that is the most correct.
Yes, and on that same line, more or less, how should we go about making sure that research that was conducted in the past, maybe like by people that came a couple of generations before us, how can we ensure that that research is still accurate and relevant in the present? Like, what's the best practice surrounding incorporating new learnings into older research?
Well, I think, and that is something we have to constantly think about. And the work I do in the agora is with skeletons, some of which were dug in the 1930s. In fact, a lot of them were. And one of the things I think is important, and I suspect in classes, sometimes students get frustrated with the fact I spend a lot of time on the history of the science and I make you learn the names of some of the important people who came before and such. But one of the ways we can interpret the earlier research is to understand what they could know given the state of the science at that point. And in some cases, the science, whether it was in the 1930s or the 1830s or the 1730s, the science might have been good enough to come to those conclusions. But we do have to understand how the discipline has developed. And so that's why, whether it's paleopathology or not so much in osteology, but in other classes, I try to give you a little bit of the framework of how we got here, so that people can evaluate what the people who made these earlier decisions and conclusions could know based on the science that we use today, if that makes sense.
Yes. No, that's actually an excellent piece of advice, because it's something that I feel anxious about often. Like, how can I just go on and hypothetically conduct research that is based off of someone else's work if I don't know like what I should check about their work or what I shouldn't? So I think it's a very valuable piece of advice to stop and think like, okay, based on the current science, what could I possibly know that might not yet be reflected in like this other piece of work?
Right.
So that's how I ended up interpreting your advice. And I think it's very good. And I feel like it mellows me out a bit.
Yeah.
So I feel that for many undergraduate students, when you talk about research, I feel like we haven't really fully quite grasped how long research takes and how slow, very slow, the research process is. So do you think you could walk me through what a research day in the lab would look like for you, like what you managed to like get done in a day, and what your general like timeline of studies would look like?
Well, when I'm here in Athens and have access to the skeletal material, much of the research, of course, I'm doing is on the bones. So I'm doing a lot of data collecting. I usually try to get here to the lab by 9 o'clock in the morning. As you may know, I like cats and I foster cats for a group called Nine Lives Greece. So, you know, I've got to clean litter boxes and feed cats, and I've got a kitten right now who's only about 10 weeks old. So she needs a little play and attention. But, you know, if I can get here by 9, I'm doing well. I usually start in the morning working with the bones. Most of the time I will have arranged things the evening before with sort of a problem, or here's what I want to look at, or here's the, you know, if I'm just doing inventory, here's what I do next. I will do that for 2 or 3 or 4 hours. The American School serves lunch at 1, and so if I've signed up for lunch, which means they aren't serving eggplant. I don't like eggplant. But if it's not eggplant, which is a big thing in Greece, I usually will go eat at 1 o'clock, and it's just up the hill on a lovely terrace outdoors now. It's very nice. And get to talk to some of my colleagues and see what they're doing and things like that. And then get back about 2. And sometimes at that point, I sort of need a break. And so I come up here to the library and we'll look up things, you know, questions. Yesterday afternoon, I needed to go review the anatomy of the space sort of between the Achilles tendon and the posterior side of the tibia. What's going on the calcaneus in that space? And so I dragged down 5 or 6 anatomy books and looked at all of them and just reviewed that. Other times, I mean, I've got stacks of printouts here of articles. It used to be Wi-Fi in Greece was so slow that you couldn't look up something quickly in an online journal. And so when you finally got it to download, we'd print them out and then keep these things in collections. Now it's not really necessary, but when I first started working on leprosy, I printed a whole bunch of articles. And so I'll come up here and page through them and find things like, yeah, I am seeing that. Okay, that makes sense. And so I often will do that for an hour or so after lunch. And then go back and work. Sometimes I'll leave about 5 or 6 on Mondays and Fridays now, even though, you know, there's a lot less going on. The dormitory's closed, that sort of thing. But we have ouzo hour when we get together and have a drink before dinner. And now we're doing it on the roof of the library. There's a terrace and there's a wonderful breeze in the evening. So it's, you know, lots of air circulation. So it's good and safe. And the very first night we went up there, I've been making masks all spring for a group in Elmira that was giving them to frontline workers and such, and I've just kept making them. And so I took party favors the first night, and I took enough masks for everybody to have a cloth mask. And people are wearing them. They're showing up at lunch and ouzo hour with them. Now, obviously, we have to take them off. But so I joke about ouzo hour being the way the American school tells us it's time to stop working now. So usually about 7. And in a normal summer, there would be ouzo hour every night at 7. Right now it's just Mondays and Fridays. But so that's kind of the day. And then I go home and feed kittens and clean out litter boxes and work on my email and read the news, and you know, so it's early in the day in Canada, and so I'll catch up on everything and often collapse in bed before 10 and get up about 6:30 the next morning and do it all over again.
Of course. And then just like for a frame of reference, How many years have you been working on research over in Greece?
Well, I'm laughing because I came to Greece in 1987 for the first time and started working on an excavation that I ended up doing my dissertation on. So began that project in 1987. This winter, just before COVID hit and the world came apart, we submitted the two volumes of publication on those cemeteries. Wow. So 1987 to 2020, wow. That was an unusually long project. But I was laughing a couple of days ago. I'm at the stage with this Byzantine cemetery of going back and reworking on things. You know, I didn't know there was leprosy in every single grave when I started. And I didn't know what leprosy looked like, except the really extreme cases. So I'm going back to the early graves and revisiting the bones and discovering way more evidence than I captured the first time. But I pulled out the data sheets from grave 4. So very early on, it was the summer I started working on the bones and realized the date I had written on the top of the sheet was 2010. So I've been working on this project, which I think of as my new project that I just got started on for 10 years. So yeah, it's a pretty lengthy process. I mean, they finished digging, I believe, in 2014. And then there were several study seasons there on site, you know, working with the whole team. And then for the last 2 years, I'm sorry to say that I and the woman doing the ethnobotany are the only people they're waiting for to finish, but it turned into a huge complex cemetery, so it's taking a while.
Yeah. I feel like a recurring theme that I've heard across these interviews is that the number one skill that you need to have as an academic is not necessarily it's obviously expertise in your field, but it's most of all patience.
Patience, absolutely.
Because results are not going to come overnight. You have to like hem and haw over like what you've learned for a long period of time. Yeah. I read someplace that research is just really like erroring in your mind. I can't remember that well, but it's something that has stuck with me. And I feel like how long your research has been taking place for is really just like testament to that. And you still always find new things to do. You still find all the time. It really never ends.
Yes, but if you need instant gratification, this type of research is not the field for you.
So to anyone listening, you have to be patient.
Right. Well, those books that, you know, I started on it in 1987 and submitted in 2020, if they are in print for the classical archaeology meetings in January of 2022, it'll be a miracle. I suspect what they will have at those meetings is a proof copy so people can see what it's going to look like, but they won't be bound and printed then. So,
yeah. So what I wanted to ask you now is, well, we know that you've dedicated most of your career to studying human remains in Greece, particularly the Athenian Agora. And out of your different studies, the one that I personally find the most interesting is your work surrounding perinatal infant mortality and the disposal of infants in whelps. So what I wanted to know is, what have you discovered to be the circumstances surrounding their high mortality and their disposal?
Okay. Yeah, the well you're referring to is the one that had about 450 fetal and infant remains in it. And boy, that was one where not jumping to the, you know, exciting, sensational conclusion was really important. You know, a lot of people have said, oh, it's infanticide, it's evidence of infanticide. I won't put all the pieces together, but ultimately what we put together was these a lot of the infants are preterm or you know, very early miscarriages, and or you know, they, obviously their skeletal remains, so they're not that early, but and then there are a lot around full term birth, but it stops very abruptly, except for four older infants. All of these babies die, you know, shortly after a full term pregnancy, or they're the size of an infant at the end of a full term pregnancy. And we found a lot of evidence for pathology, particularly infections. Infants are very prone to bacterial infections from cutting the umbilical cord. There were some birth defects and things. So we think there may have been some children who were exposed or abandoned. But for the most part, we think these are natural infant deaths. There was a ceremony called the amphidromia in which it was a rite of passage, and it sort of incorporated the infant into the family. The head of the household, which wasn't necessarily the father, but the head of the household, would accept the infant as a family member. And this took place normally at the seventh or eighth day, sometimes as late as the 10th day, but you know, it was a family ceremony. And I gave some measurement data to Lyle Konigsberg, who is an anthropological demographer. Some of you may have stumbled across his work. Lyle deals with numbers in a way that most of us don't want to think about them. But he was working on modeling natural infant mortality, and so was looking for collections of infant bones. And I gave them to him, and then he got back to me and he said, this is really interesting. I think this is natural infant mortality. It looks just like that. But what's bizarre is they are all dead by about the eighth day after 40 weeks, you know, which is full-term pregnancy. I said, well, that's interesting, Lyle. Let me tell you about the amphidromia that was on day 7 or 8. So surprisingly, I mean, the data really came back to support that these are all babies who died before that. The reason we think they're all in a well is that if they weren't yet part of the family, they wouldn't have been buried formally in the cemeteries. And we know that midwives were very much involved in births at this point. Midwifery was one of the few professions open to women. And it was something women were very proud of. They put it on their tombstones. I mean, you know, it's an important part of medical care. We know that midwives took care of the mother and infant up to the amphidromia. And in fact, the midwife participated in the ceremony. So you've got midwives where with any birth, when it's over, they're gonna have, you know, a couple of pounds of wet, slimy placenta that somebody's gotta get rid of. And we know that it was their job to clean up afterwards and take the placenta away. And if the infant is stillborn or dies before that amphidromia, they may also be being asked to dispose of the bodies. We don't know that for sure. We know they cleaned up the afterbirth and we know they participated in the amphidromia, but it would not be illogical for the head of household to say, well, it's not really a part of the family yet. It's not even really human yet. Why did you take this away? And this well had been abandoned. It was in a former industrial area that had been sort of cleaned up. And we think the midwives were using it probably to dispose of the placentas, and then the babies that didn't survive were going into it. And the pottery associated with them is about a 25-year period. So honestly, 450 babies is not that many for an ancient city over 25 years. So this wasn't all the babies dying in Athens in that period, but it's probably, you know, a midwife who lived in the neighborhood, or maybe a couple of them were using it. So that's what we think is going on with that.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And I feel like it goes into my next question. I was rewatching the play Antigone the other day, and it really highlights how important death rites are within Greek culture, to the extent that Antigone was willing to do this whole debacle.
Right.
So be able to like properly bury her brother, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right. So would you say, now that you tell me about the amphidromia, I can't make sense of that. Would you say that they were being disposed in the well due to their lack of having gone through that ceremony and then being considered like family members or human beings either? Or why do you think otherwise that these midwives or these like families might have been able to dispose the babies without fear of like retribution from the deities?
Right. Well, it may be that there was some fear there. There is some pottery with the babies, although most of, you know, and pottery was a common grave gift. Most of it is so large that it's basins and things that we actually think the babies were being carried in. So it's not like pretty pottery put in a grave. But what's interesting is that mixed in with these babies were the bones of at least 250 dogs. And they don't look like so-called urban die-off, you know, city street dogs. If they just die off, that's been pretty well documented. And the zooarchaeologists can say, yeah, that looks like natural dog mortality. These are more either puppies or young adults, although there are a few old adults too. There doesn't seem to be anything special about these dogs. Dogs weren't very often sacrificed in the ancient world, but the one thing they did was take away ritual pollution. That miasma, that dangerous quality that you can get when things are done wrong or you're exposed to something inappropriate. And so we suspect the midwives were sacrificing these dogs to protect themselves, but as a way of, you know, calming the spirits of the babies or whatever. The ancient Greeks didn't really believe in ghosts. They're not like the Romans, who are kind of big on ghosts. But there was a concern about improper death and improper burial. And then there were a few things. I mean, for example, there were 6 or 8, maybe even 10. It's been a while since I've looked at the pottery. But they're these sort of long tubes that have a bulge in the middle that were perfume flasks, very commonly found in graves. Some of those were found in mixed in with the bones. So there seem to have been a few typical grave offerings, not many at all, but a few, and then all these dogs. So we think the midwives were concerned about this and were doing something to propitiate the spirits, the pollution, whatever.
Yeah, that's actually very interesting. It was just something that I kept on thinking about it as I saw the play again, and I was like,
Right. Yeah.
There's just like a huge disconnect there, so there must be something Dr. Liston must know. I will ask.
Well, you know, until we invent a time machine and go back and watch, we don't know for sure. But the pieces fit together pretty nicely on the evidence for this.
And that's one of the most fun, if I can say fun. Most fun things about the archaeological sciences, I feel, because you get to just build this entire puzzle of everything that happened, and it's just cool. It's a wonderful field. I'm very proud to play a small role in it.
It's one of the reasons I think archaeology is important for undergraduates. If I can, you know, jump in. With it, we look at impartial, damaged, fragmentary data sets and learn how to draw, you know, robust, repeatable conclusions. That's one of the so-called transferable skills that the humanities and social sciences are supposed to be providing to undergraduates. You know, that's what we do. We happen to make it fun and interesting instead of tedious and boring. But that's what you're learning, is how to draw together multiple lines of evidence with badly fragmented data and come up with good answers. So, you know, there you go. Everybody take archaeology.
I mean, I'm definitely biased, but I always say and I always think that anthropologists are the best professionals and that everyone should have an anthropologist just like around. So thank you for supporting. Yeah, thank you for agreeing. But as for people that specifically want to go into some sort of archaeological field, whether it's like like archaeology or bioarchaeology. How do you continue finding relevant areas of study in a researcher-saturated field that is, to an extent, experiencing a shortage in research subjects because that remain buried? I know that it is a common preoccupation amongst my peers, where some of them want to go and study in like a Greco-Roman context, and they're like, they're gonna discover it all. I'm gonna have like nothing else left to research when my time comes. But you've been at this for so long. So I wanted to know, how do we as researchers become relevant, and how do we stay relevant? How do we continue finding things to study?
Well, the first thing I'll do in terms of studying skeletal remains is the ancient Romans had it right. The Romans referred to the dead as the majority. And they recognized that more people have died in all of the past than are alive now. There are a whole lot more skeletons out there to study. Within Greece and Italy, or the Roman world, or the Greco-Roman world, you've got laws that protect ancient heritage, and they require that any remains be properly excavated and properly found if development is going to take place. And development's taking place all the time. Roads are being built and rebuilt, and cities are expanding, and populations grow, and you build more housing and stores and malls and all of that, unless it's all replaced by the internet post-COVID. But so, in fact, the problem in Greece certainly is there is way more material that needs to be studied than there are people who can possibly get it done. Every museum has storerooms. They call them apothecaries. And there are apothecaries just crammed with material that nobody has studied that was excavated as part of a road expansion, or somebody's adding a wing onto their house, and lo and behold, discover they're sitting on top of a, early Iron Age cemetery or whatever. So, in fact, there's a tremendous amount that needs to be studied, and we're just beginning to, get enough data to put together a nice big picture. But there's a whole lot left to do.
Of course. And I think that's also very encouraging, that idea of the dead are the majority, not encouraging like in general, but for the people that want to go into, into bioarchaeology. There will always be something else to research. You can always like model your research in a different way. And then even like as you've proven with like your career, you can start with like this one project, and then that project like flourishes into like seven more.
Yes.
And then
yes.
Your new project of the last decade.
Yeah.
In that sense.
Every project for me has led to another project. You do good work, and you treat people nicely, and you try to be a polite guest on their project, or a real team member, and you do all those things, and you get a reputation of being that person, and then you get invited to the next one. And it's just been sort of sequential for me, one after another.
Of course. And then we have some audience questions from our crowd.
Okay.
And there's someone that's asking, what made you interested in the area of the world that you study? I feel like what led you originally were?
Well, before I was an anthropologist, I was a classicist. In college, I was a double major in English and classics, and then I did a master's degree in classics. And it took me 6 years, I'm somewhat slow, it took me 6 years to figure out I did not want to make a living translating Latin. And I didn't really want to write a dissertation on Latin poetry like I thought I was going to. And so I wanted to shift to archaeology. And at that point, anthropological archaeology and classical archaeology were very far apart. But anthropological archaeology was starting to, graduate students were discovering it and irritating their professors with it. And it was causing a lot of problems, really, in classics. And I pretty much wanted to see what this was about, if it was making them so angry or so nervous. And so I had planned to just take a few courses one summer at the University of Tennessee and see what this anthropology stuff was about. And three intro courses and a second year course in bioanth in a summer, and I was hooked. And did another bachelor's degree. It only took a year because I could transfer everything but the major. So I did another bachelor's degree in a year and then applied to PhD programs in classical archaeology. But the chair of the department at Tennessee, Bill Bass, kept saying, "You're an anthropologist. You need to stay here." And so I did. classics got me into archaeology and archaeology got me into bones. So it wasn't planned, I have to say. It was following courses I loved.
Of course. And then I feel like that's one of the most important things that you have to be as an anthropologist. Like, you have to really love what you do. And you have to really be passionate about it, because I feel like otherwise it can scare mere mortals away.
Yeah, it was a long, I mean, I was 32 when I finished my PhD. And a lot of my contemporaries from high school, owned houses and had careers, and I was just finishing up. So you did need to love it. But on the other hand, I went to Greece every summer and I just had the best possible time doing it. So I didn't spend, once in a lifetime 2-week vacation in Greece or a week long cruise. I spent 10 to 12 weeks every summer in Greece. So for me, that was a trade-off that was just fine.
Yeah. Let's see. Someone else is asking, what's your favorite course to teach and why?
Oh, I love the osteology course. Because it's so hands-on. I love the fact that it's in the lab and I'm right there, we've just got this circle of people around the table and I get to interact with you all so much. And I love it when people get excited about learning these bones and when it clicks. And, some people will struggle at the beginning with this different type of learning, the shape of things. That's not something you've had to do since kindergarten, possibly. And it's exciting when it clicks. But I like the fact that it's a pretty small class and there's lots of interaction, and it for me is, that review is useful. I pick up little details and things. I learn something from it every time I teach it. But it's a lot of fun. I mean, I enjoy all my courses. I taught 204 for the first time last year. I can't believe I've been at Waterloo this long and never taught that course. And that was great fun, covering all of this at a sort of beginning level, but getting back, looking at the big picture of the field of bioanth again. I loved it. And skeletal biology is just more of osteology. And so it's fun. I love my field and I'm very fortunate about that.
Well, as I told you, one of my favorite courses of all time has been human osteology. It was so different from every other course that I've ever taken it. I recommend that course to everyone that's in anthropology and beyond. It really is great. So, I'm really appreciative of the way that you teach it and the way that you help us learn this material that otherwise would be so dense. And it could, if you're not particularly interested, it could become very tedious.
Even I would admit that.
I walked in not being particularly keen on bones, and then I walked out of the course just like with a whole new perspective on on bioarchaeology. So thank you for that. And then we have a couple more questions. What piece of advice would you give to similar students who are finishing up a major that they're not completely sure about? I feel like it's regarding our switching.
Yeah. Right. Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, and I certainly switched. I went to school planning to be a veterinarian and be a biology major. So I'm a poster child for switching your major. you need to find something you love and that you love it because you're willing to work hard at it. Not that you love it because it's easy and you don't have to invest in it. And if that's not the field you're in, you're not going to be a success at the career that field leads to. And you're going to spend 40 years doing something that bored you when you were an undergraduate. So how's it going to get any better if you thought it was dull at the beginning? So you need to find what you love and what you're good at. But again, good at because you're willing to really work at it. Not good at it because it takes zero effort. So if you're not in that field, then you may need to rethink this, or you at least need to tweak it a little bit. I was really, very blessed that my parents were quite supportive of my, starting all over with another bachelor's degree after finishing a master's degree. I think they were a little shocked, but they did cope, and I was mostly paying my own way, but they helped a little bit. They kept me on their health insurance, for example, which is a big deal in the U.S. And I was tweaking. I knew I liked studying the ancient past, but the literature wasn't the way for me. That was not what I really wanted to be doing, and so it took me a little while to find that. And so, your education's an investment in your future. And if what you're putting your time and effort into is not something you want to do for the rest of your life or the rest of your working life, then you may want to rethink that a little bit. So that would be my advice. And just because a course of study is supposed to lead to a high paying job, if you're terrible at it because you hate it, you're not going to have a high paying job. So you're not even going to accomplish that.
Yeah. Of course. And then just bringing it back, like, we only have this one life, and then afterwards we move on to being the majority, and we don't know what happens there. Yeah. So might as well do something that we're willing to, like, work hard on. And, like, I feel like I'm very, like, results oriented. So I love seeing, like, my good work. I love having something that I can be proud of. So that's really good advice. How would I be able to, like, be proud of something that I don't really enjoy doing? So it's all a cycle. We have one more audience question, and they say, have you ever encountered trouble with developers or government in Greece because of your excavations?
No, not really. I mean, I'm fortunate that Greece is so committed to its past and to making sure that remains are properly excavated and preserved. Sometimes I wish they were a little less committed to that preservation. This winter, 4 years after applying to get some DNA analysis from this cemetery, finally got the permit, and literally this morning finally got permission to ship the bones. Wow. So, and the problem was there's this great hesitance to do anything that damages anything, including crummy little ribs and not very interesting teeth that were loose in the grave. But so, the problems are frustration with that. But, this is Greece. The Greeks have a right to decide how their material is studied, and it's important that we remember we're guests here. And so we work within the system, and if it takes 4 years to get that permit, then that's what it took. So, but fortunately, the other issue, and I'm surprised somebody hasn't asked this, dealing with human remains. I dig up graves, or I study dug up graves, but the North American view that your grave is yours forever is very alien in Europe. Europe's too old. The majority would take up the entire, every square inch of Europe would be covered in graves if graves were kept forever. And in Greece, because the land's so, there's so little usable land, most people only stay buried about 5 to 7 years. And so you attend your grandmother's funeral, And then a few years later, you attend the exhumation of your grandmother's body and or skeleton, and you hope it's skeletalized at that point. So there's no discomfort with digging up graves of people who died 1500 or 2500 years ago. We're not violating social mores. We're treating them, you know, the way people literally have treated their own relatives. So it does make it an easier place to work because of that, because what we're doing is an acceptable part of culture.
Greek does have a really big, really strong, like, chthonic culture.
Yes.
So as long as you treat the bones with respect and just don't use them for anything that we would be considered, like, humiliating, then it makes sense that people at large support it. And let's see, as for now, we are moving on to the this or that segment, where I give you two options of things, and then you tell me which one's your favorite or which one you're most interested in, and you can give me a follow-up if you want, but if not, we can just, like, move on to the next one. Okay?
Okay.
So number one, tarsals or carpals?
I think tarsals. And that's the result of this project, where, in fact, bodies have been partially exhumed, and most of what I have is legs and feet. I spend all of my time working on legs and feet, for the most part. So, yes, I really love tarsals now.
Okay. Lumbar, thoracic, or cervical vertebrae?
I think cervicals. I think they're interesting, and I like the, you know, the fact that the first and second are different. And so, yes, cervicals.
I think I personally like lumbar more because they look like little moose.
Yes.
I think that's cute. But okay, so basal, pinta, or yaws?
None of the above, please. Wow. Basal's probably the least severe, so if I gotta have one of them, I'll take basal.
Or, like, in terms of being interesting to study, maybe.
Oh, well, yaws shows up on bones some, but basal and penta, as far as we don't know, don't most of the time. It's usually yaws and syphilis that appear on bones, so.
Okay.
But interesting. I've never found an archaeological case, though. I've it's one thing I've never seen.
Jane Bykstra or Wilhelm Møller Christensen?
I want to be Jane Bykstra when I grow up. And I tell her this occasionally. I see her in a meeting and, you know, anthropologists sitting around. And I've actually only told her that once, but it really made her laugh. I have great admiration for her work, and I think she's been such an important influence on the field.
She really has been, and I admire, what's the name of the field guide she put together?
You mean the standards for data collection from human skeletal remains?
The standards.
Yes, the standards. Okay, well, here, this will make you happy. Let me pick up my computer and look over my head. You see that chair right there behind me? That's where Jane Bykstra was sitting in February and March.
Wow.
So she's on the board of trustees of the American School as the lab representative, and she's the director of this big Phaleron project. And I sat with my back to Jane pretty much every afternoon for part of February and March.
Yeah. I used standards so much this past winter when I was taking forensics, and I was just always like, thank you, Jane Bykstra.
Yes. Well, I have to tell you, I should have gotten better organized. Tom Schack, who taught the skeletal biology and forensics in the winter, is working here in the lab now.
Oh, he arrived,
yes, he arrived last weekend, and he's working on the Phaleron project. And I realized as he was leaving for the evening that I should have made him stick around. So But if you want to interview him about what he's working on, we can talk him into doing that.
Reply to my emails. I've emailed him. He's not getting back to me. Tell him.
Oh, okay. All right. I'll give him a hard time. I'm not his advisor anymore, but I can pick on him.
Of course. Okay. Rickets or scurvy?
I think scurvy to study.
Yeah, I would have chosen scurvy as well. Let's see. Trepanation or trepanation?
Trepanation. And I won't bore you with linguistic reasons for that, but yes, I think it's trepanation.
Okay. Dish or ankylosing spondylitis?
I would love to see a case of Dish. That's sort of on my, you know, my life list of pathologies I want to find. I've never found Dish before. I have found some ankylosing spondylitis, but both of them are fascinating and, of course, hard to tell apart if you don't have a whole skeleton to look at. But
yeah, it was a major point of contingency in your paleopathology exams. I'd be like, which one is this, Dish or is this? I still get PTSD from that, but we're good. Juvenile or adult bones?
Right now, juvenile, in part because I've invested so much effort, you know, in the last 10 or 15 years of really getting better at juvenile bones. So I'm still excited when I see this. Like, oh yeah, let's see what's going on here. On the other hand, they're sad, of course, but.
Yeah. And then one final this or that question. So the Anthropology Society at Waterloo or the Anthropology Society at Waterloo?
The Anthropology Society at Waterloo absolutely is the best.
Great answer. Wow. Thank you.
I'm impressed with this that you're doing.
Well, and on that note, I think it's time for us to say goodbye now. Thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Liston. I know that this was a very awaited and expected interview, so I'm glad we got to do this. As always, we're going to be posting the interview to YouTube. We're going to upload the transcript. We're going to write an article about this. So just really thank you so much for your time.
Well, thank you for the invitation. It has been so much fun. I'm sorry the technology failed us and we couldn't do quite as much of a lab tour as I'd hoped, but we overcame the obstacles and it's been a lot of fun. Thank you.
Of course. And that's the moral of this pandemic story, just like overcoming obstacles, adjusting to new situations, and then being able to rise above that. But
thank you
so much. Said, have a good rest of your evening, night.
Yes, evening. I'm going to head home and feed that kitten and play with it a little bit. I actually have three foster cats right now, so I will have a nice evening and get up tomorrow morning and work on bones. So it's a good week.
Yeah, well, thanks, Dr. List, and then have a good night. And I'm just going to unplug us from the live.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Goodbye.